Our wake-up call today, and it's a wake-up in many different ways, I think, is someone who's going to remind us why this conference is important, why what you do is important. Please welcome Jason Anker, who's director, Jason Anker Live Limited. He's a motivational safety speaker, and he will take, I hope, a few questions from you at the end. Please welcome Jason Anker.
Good morning. Thank you for inviting me to speak. 3 years ago, it was my first real major talk I ever did. It was for IOSH, the Tailored Course Approval Launch Scheme in London. And back then, I had a 15 minutes talk. I had to pad it out for 30 minutes. Well, today things have changed. I've got a 60 minute talk and I've got to narrow it down to 30. So I'm struggling a bit on time. I've only got two rules. My first rule is mobile phones. You've asked to switch them off. But my rule is, if your mobile phone does go off from now on, you've got to leave it really in your pocket, come up onto the stage and dance to your ringtone in front of everybody. Is that okay? And my only second rule is, I still get really, really nervous doing this. And if I say anything remotely funny, you have to laugh. Because if you remain silent, it absolutely terrifies me. I've sort of realized quite quickly that this is not just a story of an accident. I'll tell you very briefly what I did in probably a couple of minutes. What I wanted to talk to you about is what it's actually done to my life and the people it's affected, not just today, every single day. So a brief bit of background of the accident. 1992, I'm a contractor on a power station. We got laid off for the season. I went working for my father-in-law, who ran a small roofing company. And I wasn't an experienced roofer, but I'd worked at height most of my working life. But on this particular day, we'd been doing a job and everything was relatively safe. And then the last hour of the job, it came in, the rush job, and things changed. So I went to a job that we wasn't planning on doing, and it was a 2-hour job that we had to get done in an hour. And quite simply, I went up a ladder that wasn't tied on, that wasn't footed, and I fell. Got taken to hospital, and it was quickly told to me that, quite simply, that I'd suffered a severe spinal injury and I'd never walk again. A couple of days later, I was transferred to Sheffield to a specialist spinal injuries unit. And again, being 24, I truly believed I'd been sent there to learn how to walk, like it is in the movies. But you quickly became aware you are there to learn how to use a wheelchair and look after yourself on a daily basis. What does that mean? Well, quite simply, you're told how to look after your bladder and how to look after your bowels. And again, I do sort of apologise for being a little bit graphic. But if I don't talk about everything I have to go through, then I'm not doing my job right. A nurse came to me after about 3 weeks of lying flat on my back. And she brought with her one of these. And she just said to me, for the rest of your life, you will have to wear a bag. And I actually laughed. And I said, no chance, you know, I'm not wearing one of them. That's what old people have to wear. Can you just tell me my other options? And she just said to me, I'm really sorry to say, but in your case, this is your only option. Now, she also came to the bed with one of these things, these condom type things. Now, I have to wear one of these 24 hours a day. And it is now just turned 20 years since my accident, and I still detest this. They are a lot more reliable than what they were, but they're not 100%. Now, everywhere I go, I have to carry a bag of clothes with me just in case something goes wrong. But in the earlier days, these used to come off at a rate of probably once or twice a month. And you'd always be sat in the pub when your mates when it happened. These ones in particular, these ones came out about 10, 11 years ago. And these were actually developed by NASA for the spacemen. Now, it might not sound very much to you, but I look at it, I am on stage forever my train to be a spaceman than any one of you people. Oh, it sort of cheers me up a little bit. But without doubt, the hardest thing you'll have to deal with is how you get to the toilet. So I'm taken to the toilet, sat there, and the nurse passed me a tube of this stuff, like a laxative, and some rubber gloves. And without going into too many descriptions, you squeeze this up your backside, wait about 10 minutes, put on a rubber glove, and leave the rest up to you, how you want to describe. I was 24, and it was the first time since my accident I actually cried. I actually thought to myself that I couldn't do it. And the first time actually took me over an hour. But I went back onto my bed, crying most of the day, and that evening my wife turned up with my kids. And my daughter Abby sat on the end of my bed, and I just thought to myself, I've not really got a choice in this. So I decided to get myself as fit as I could and get out of this bloody hospital. On April the 25th, 1993, I'm discharged. All my friends away from me took me down the pub, and they'd raised a load of money for a new wheelchair. I get home, wake up Saturday morning, and my wife says to me, you stay in bed. I'll take the kids from mum's. I'll see you later. And I've been there most of the day, sort of late afternoon, and I get the phone call. And it was from her mum. And she just said to me, look, there's no easy way of saying this, but she's not coming back. She's left you. So I was out of hospital for one day. And on the very first day, she walked out with the kids. Now, in her defence, she was 23 at the time. My daughter Abby was 3, and my son Sam, he was nearly 1. She's not here today to give her side of the story about how my accident affected her life. And I suppose it would be quite easy for me just to sit here and slag her off. So I will. What a bitch, eh? Nah, it's a cheap line I set every time. It always cheers me up. Total reality, she came to the hospital every single day. She didn't drive. She got a lift 50 miles to the hospital, 50 miles home. And she, like me, true believer, I was going to walk out of there. And when it became obvious that I wasn't, she couldn't face it, and she left. Your mates will always rally around and do the best they can. But again, blokes being blokes, we are rubbish at this sort of thing. And we never only one cure to try and cheer somebody up, which is what? Yeah. When you're in hospital initially, people come to visit you on a daily basis, and you are the victim. But the moment you leave hospital, you become everybody's counsellor. People don't want to hear about that you're not coping, so you put on a brave face. And unfortunately, the only way I could get through it, I was on antidepressants, I was drinking really heavily, and within a few months, I was actually taking drugs. Drug of choice was ecstasy. It wasn't about getting high, it was about coping. And unfortunately, it was the only way I could cope. Over the next 2 years, things sort of spiraled out of control. Things getting worse and worse and worse. And nobody could stop it. In fact, my daughter Abby came to me full time in the autumn of 94 to try to give me that focus. But it was too late. And in the January of 1995, I'm out somewhere. I've taken a couple of these tablets. And Cameron was starting to feel a little bit different, a little bit unwell. The next thing I can actually remember is opening my eyes, staring at a white ceiling, and I didn't have a clue where I was. I was back in Nottingham. I was in an intensive care unit. I'd been in a coma for 17 days, suspected serious brain damage. There came a point after about 15 days where my mum and dad was told there was nothing else to go do for me. And they had to make the choice of switching the machine off. Luckily for me, my dad said no way. But Fortunately, on day 17, I actually opened my eyes. I couldn't speak. I was still on a ventilator. The brain damage I suffered was not as bad as they expected. But even today, I still really, really struggle. Something with short-term memory. Speech-wise, at the time, I could barely string about 3 or 4 words together. And I spent the next 5 months in a hospital, literally learning how to speak again, how to dress myself, how to feed myself, even how to go to the toilet in the morning. If anybody was thinking of shaking my hand later on, I suggest you have a good think where this one's been before you do, okay? But I came out of hospital with a new determination. My daughter had come back to me full time, and I was quite fortunate to stumble upon Waterskiing. The first time since my accident I'd done anything that didn't involve this bloody wheelchair. So I started a little bit of water skiing, looking after my daughter Abby, seeing my son Sam as much as I could, still drinking far too much, but I'm coping. And in 1998, 5 years after my accident, I was finally offered an out-of-court offer of compensation. But it was for less than half the value of my claim. And it was simply put to me, look, the end of the day, you went up a ladder, wasn't tied on. If we get to court, 25% negligible, 50%, we're probably running a 50-50 risk of actually going to court, coming out with nothing. So I accepted the offer. I was told I'd be paid in 3 months, but a couple of weeks later, my sister rings me up and says, I'm really sorry to say, there's a few more complications. Probably be another couple of years. So the year 2000, my son Sam, he's 8 years old, and he asked me if he can come and live with me and his sister. And I spoke with my ex-wife, she was remarried, and she agreed. Well, I'll always remember the day my dad went to pick him up. Sam come back, come walking down the drive, a little bag on his back with some of his clothes. But what do most 8-year-old lads carry with them absolutely everywhere? Yeah, football. And you tell me, oh, I'd miss this for 8 years, but I'm sat in the garden with my mum, the patio. Lovely summer's day, watching my dad kick football around the garden with my son. And I just suddenly became aware that I was only kicking football with my boy. And I don't think I'd cried since I'd come out of the hospital. I went back in the house and I absolutely sobbed. You know, football was such a massive part of my life, and to know because of something that I did at work one day that I knew was unsafe, I've never kicked football with my boy. Now, I might not do these talks 4 or 5 days a week, sometimes 3 times a day. And I'm now quite comfortable sitting in front of complete strangers going through all the personal crap I have to go through. But honestly, me getting through this little bit of talking about me and my kids over the last 3 years, this bit does not seem to get any easier. I think another bad one for me was, do you know, like, I've been learning to ride a bike, and they've had the stabiliser on for a couple of weeks, they've been through all the training, and then it comes to the big day. You take the stabiliser off a bike, you hold onto the bike seat, and you make them a promise, and you promise them faith that you're not going to let go. But as they get pulled away, you go to the bike seat, and it's that moment. They get sort of 10, 15 feet down the path, put their foot down for the very first time. Suddenly come where they rode a bike, and turn around and look at you. And you sort of well up inside that, proud you makes you feel. At the end of the day, I had to sit and watch my dad do that. And it's not my memory, it's my dad's memory. And the guilt I feel for not being able to do the things that dad should do, because of something that I did at work one day, that I knew was unsafe. My daughter Abinah, she's 23. She's a lovely daughter. She's got a lovely boyfriend. And yeah, they have been talked about getting married. How the hell am I supposed to walk my daughter down the aisle? And I eventually get some grandkids. Am I ever going to bounce my grandkids on my shoulder at the seaside? No. Because of something that I did at work one day that I knew was unsafe. But I got away from the kids, I got my water skin, again, still drinking far too much. In 2005, I get my day in court. My compensation claim had risen quite considerably over the years. But that's where in court, their barrister stands up and says, we'll agree to pay the money we'd agreed on in 98. And it was simply put to me, look, if we continue and win, you will get substantially more. But please be aware, we are still in that 50-50 risk of coming here today with nothing. So I again accepted the offer. Again, told me paid in 3 months. It actually took another 2 years. So I was finally paid some compensation action in January 2007, which was 14 years after my accident. Now, my case is very complex. There was loads of problems along the way, but I'd finally got it. And I truly believe that that was the end of the story, and also my life would become okay. And probably for the first time since my accident, I actually became aware of how bloody depressed I was. And yet, I got all this money in the bank. So I started spending. Got a nice flat where I live, paid cash for it, have a new car when I feel like it, nice clothes, nice holidays. I could have what I wanted. And nothing seemed to have any sense to me. I have a lot of friends who live over in Tenerife. I used to go there for 2 months at a time. Fly back into the UK, now what? Spend a load of money, what's next? Back to Tenerife. And this went on through 2007 and 2008. But Christmas 2008, I'm in the UK, Christmas party, a little bit drunk. And a guy comes over to me, complete stranger. And he just comes out with, so why are you in a wheelchair, mate? Have you had an accident? And I said, yeah, where car? I fell off a ladder. He said, do you mind telling me your story? And I said, look, with the greatest respect, mate, who are you? And he introduced himself. So I do behavioural safety. I truly believe that sometimes that accident, coming back into the workplace, sharing experiences, it could make a difference. And I said, look, I've not spoken about this with my mates, with my family, with my dad. I don't think I've even had the conversation with myself. Be persuaded to go on a few jobs with him, and I absolutely hated it. I used to speak for about 15 minutes purely about my accent. I couldn't understand what my story had to do with anybody else. And then one day, doing a job somewhere, a young lad on his mobile phone under the table, just not listening. I don't know what came over me. I got my bag, I tipped it on the table, I told him everything. At the end of the session, he says, yeah, he says, I get it now. And in that moment, I got it. So if I have to share anything about my accident, telling people absolutely how I live, things I have to do every day, and that can stop one person going through something like this, yeah, I'm happy. I've done since I've had my conversation, I've never done for my life. I've drove rally cars, flipping microlights, doing gliders, and scuba diving, parachute jumps. Magical things I never done before my accident. And not one has come remotely close for me to say it is worth being in a wheelchair for. I actually detest the way I have to live. And quite bizarrely, the only good thing I've got in my life now is actually speaking out the thing that I was trying to forget about for 16.5 years. I was earlier this year, I was speaking at an ICE event, and the guy was a security expert. and he was there to talk about security. And I'd done my bit first. And he got into his little section saying he was an ex-Royal Marine, and he goes to places like the customs guys to talk about spotting potential drug smugglers coming through customs. There's a profile of what they're acting dressed like as they come through customs. Unfortunately, drug smugglers know that there is a profile of a drug smuggler, and they act and dress the opposite of the profile. Okay? Custom guys know that they know they know. And the bit that intrigued me was, he says, what is it most people get stopped from through customs? And it's that gut instinct that something ain't quite right. And it takes less than a second to go off in the back of your mind that something isn't quite right. And we've all got that on sight. I did that day my accident that something wasn't quite right. And I chose to ignore it. It's a quick job. I stopped putting them barriers in place. As a result of that decision, I now spend the rest of my life in a wheelchair. You have to listen to your gut instinct that something isn't quite right and ask the question. Now, I realise that I'm a good-looking guy, right? No, you weren't supposed to laugh at me, by the way. But I was 24 at my accident, and if you're told you're never going to walk again, you're doubly incontinent, are there any other questions? As a 24-year-old male, what do you believe your next question would be? Again, it's a big one. Again, such a random conversation about strangers. But there you go. So I raise a question of sex, and they say, now is not the time. Go home, rebuild your life, and at some point in the future, come back to see us. I had a variety of girlfriends from coming out of hospital. The problem wasn't them, the problem was me. I was so embarrassed about being in this wheelchair. This girl, someone new before my accident, a bit more serious, moves into the house where I'm living. And I plucked the courage to ring my consult up in Sheffield. And he says, no worries, Jace, come along and see me. It's quite straightforward. So I go to Sheffield, go in, meet him, and he says, right, go into that cubicle, get on the bed, and take all your clothes off. And I was like, bloody hell. So I goes in, jumps on his table, starts taking all my clothes off. And then I think to myself, I've known this guy now for the last 9 months. He'd poked and prodded me so many times. How bad could it be? Now, do you believe my consultant came back into that cubicle? Oh no. A 20-year-old nurse comes walking through the curtain, I'm laying on this table without a stitch on, bright red, thinking, what the bloody am I going to talk to her about? So I just switch off. So she's walking around the table, and I notice that caught my eye, she's put down this little silver dish. And then it is this little bottle of liquid with like four levels to it. Next to that is a big needle with a head on it that big. So I've gone from bright red to pure white with fear. And I start to pay attention. Then she says to me, look, unfortunately, we don't know how much stuff you're going to need. You cannot afford to get it wrong. So initially, trial and error. So the first time you use it, just put a quarter into your needle. Basically get him out, needle in the hand, and basically stick it in, inject this stuff, and it should work. Don't worry, it gets worse. If, however, nothing happens, don't be alarmed. Simply wait another week and try off. If that don't work, another week. So pretend to need it all, a month. And do not drink any alcohol. So I've gone home right, and the big night arrived, and I was bloody nervous, right? So I had a few beers just to relax me a little bit. Girlfriend's in the room, laid on make all this stuff around, just thinking to myself, you're gonna have to do it. So I get my little bottle, puts a quarter in there, gets him out, and I'm just plucking up the courage to do it. And at that precise moment, I had a bit of a brainwave. It's been 9 months since my accident. If this don't work, I'm gonna have to wait another week. So what do you think I decide to do? I earned the night with half, and I thought, well, if half of them still have to wait another week, I'll sod it, I'll have it all. What can possibly go wrong? So I've got it all in there, just 3, 2, 1, stick it in, inject this up, and it was instantaneous. Now, it is what it is, I'm paralysed up from there down. So a moment passed by, I'd gone to sleep, wake up Saturday morning, Sunday morning, so I drink water, sat in bed, sort of turn around, glance down, douche, there it was, 6 hours later. wake the girlfriend. She says, don't panic, I'll drive down to the hospital. So she bundles me into the car, drives down to the hospital. 7:30 on a Sunday morning, right? I go wheeling through the casualty department. So picture the scene. I had a T-shirt on, nothing else. I had a tea towel draped across me. I wasn't going to say what I did to me. It was bloody horrendous. And yeah, there's other things on the market these days to try. But I was quite fortunate. I've got two kids. Because the chance of having kids after something like this is virtually nil. But at the end of the day, I went up a ladder, and it was unsafe. Live the consequences.
Stop and think before you do anything. You know, everything's got to be done safely. You only get one chance.
Three years ago, I was approached by, after the launch of the Irish event, I was launched by Outtakes to a safety DVD. And I sort of agreed to it. And they came out and did a little bit of filming with working and a little bit of filming with water skiing. And then they said, we'd like to go around doing an interview with mum and dad. And I went around to mum and dad's house. And that was the first time my dad spoke. And that was what I had done to my dad. And I've sat and talked about how my accident affected my life. The hardest thing I have to deal with is actually what I've done to everybody else. Now, my dad was a rough and tumble steel erector by trade, and he went back to work for a couple of years and retired to look after my mum. Now, I still struggle watching that, and the only reason I put it in was just to show people how bad my dad is. If I ran my dad now and simply told him I got a punch in my wheelchair, my dad would break down and sob. If he ever comes out for a pint, he has a couple of drinks, and he still makes an excuse to leave early. My mum, 20 years after my accident, my mum still sees a counsellor, and she's still antidepressants. Got a brother and a sister. My sister's been my rock all the way through this. My brother struggled. Not because he was embarrassed of his brother being in a wheelchair, because there was nothing he could do or say to stop me going down the road I went on. Worse I became, worse it affected my brother. And it will go through the rest of your family and your mates. Because initially, nobody does anything that you can't be involved in. But over time, weekends away, lads' holidays, rounds of golf. They go off and have a really good time, but when they come back, they see me, I'm just full of guilt that I weren't involved. Now, I've been an absolute nightmare for years after my accident. And for some people, they came to a point where it's easier not to be around me. And even today, I come up to my oldest mate, yeah, we'll sit, we'll have a good drink. And by the end of the night, eyes are always full of tears. Not just doing what I went through, but what I put them through. My kids, Abby's now 20, going 23, lovely daughter, not really had a problem. Sam's just turned 21 and he's a bit of a nightmare. We're barely speaking at the moment. He's moved out, living in a flat somewhere. But something came to me quite recently was, till he was 10, I'd never had a problem. Dad was in a wheelchair, it's all that mattered. Then one day, came from school, sat right in front of me, and he asked me the question, so why have you never played football with me then, Dad? And the reason I never played football with him is I fell 10 feet from an unsecured ladder and the look on his face. So when I got a compensation, I tried to make it up for him by buying him stuff. He was 14, he could have anything. Clothes, mobile phones, fishing tackle, have what he wanted. Left school, dropped out of college, never really working. Every weekend, getting money to go out with his mates, buying new clothes, pay for him to go on holiday. He could have what he wanted. But what was the only thing he has ever wanted to do with his dad? Play football. And there ain't no amount of compensation, no Xboxes that will ever make up to Sam. And that is the cost of an accident. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you.
Well, if there is anybody in this room who has any doubts about why you do what you do, I don't think you've got them now. Jason's kindly agreed to just take a couple of questions. Really struck me, Jason. I mean, the power of your story and how you tell it. When you read some of the newspapers that talk about health and safety and the usual kind of cartoon version of what we've been talking about the last couple of days, I just wonder what you think of that.
Personally, when I do my speeches, actually, when I work, I don't mention the word health and safety at all. So I think that's probably what it's not about. It's not about conkers, it's actually about stopping people happening. I was, 3 years ago when I first started doing this, I didn't actually know people still fell from height because they have got all the gear today and they've got things that weren't in place 20 years ago and people are still falling, people are still getting injured at work. So I'll just do anything I can possibly can to help anybody else. But there's no right answer. If there's somebody's right answer, it'd be easy, we could finish now. It's continually going, continually striving, with new ideas, new approaches, new initiatives, and hopefully one day we may get there. I have a big piece I've just come into my talk now, but it's a dead simple line I use to the guys, and it's something dead simple that it doesn't have to happen.
I mean, you obviously inspire people, Do you, when you talk to audiences, not just professional audiences, but when you talk to people who could be at risk, like the guy who wasn't paying any attention and you lost it a bit, do you feel you inspire them that you'd make a difference, that you change behaviour because they listen to you?
I'd like to think so. I do get a lot of emails sent me after I spoke from people who've been in the audience, not brave enough to speak on the day, and they'll send me an email, and that sort of inspires me to keep going. You know, if it's just one person, if one person takes a bit of notice, it's worth it.
And one of the things that we were discussing yesterday, that came up yesterday, we had a group of lawyers at the end of the day, and then people were talking about the compensation culture, which is the other kind of cartoon version. It doesn't sound like there's much of a compensation culture if it takes you 14 years to get compensation, does it?
Not really. Funny thing was, I was asked on a committee last year, I was totally unprepared, and there's some lawyers at one end and me sat at the other end. And I was talking about compensation, the compensation culture. And if a guy falls down a crappy curb and he's claimed to the £3,000, he'll probably get paid out, no real questions asked, because it's probably too expensive to even fight the claim. If somebody has a serious accident, which is probably not much fault on their part, they will be hounded to try and find out they was at fault for the accident, because if a claim's worth £1 million, it's worth casting some fault onto the person. So if they can reduce it by 25%, 30%, 40%, they'll go after every single thing. And I was, especially when I say to when I speak to the guys, is if you've done things unsafe on site, you're working unsafely, if you are an accident, it will get brought up.
Right. Just a final thought. The one thing that really struck me listening to your story is that it is a story, and every single person remembers it because it's a story. It's not a statistic, it's not a figure, you're not a bit of a graph, and that's why it's so powerful. So I think on behalf of everybody, thank you very much for talking to us. Thank you. Jason.